Quake! Trouble is ahead for America, Canada, and all the world. Soon a global leader and his religious Christian apostate partner will create the New World Order and a world religion under the united banner of Islam and Christianity. Together they rule the nations and all religions via Sharia law. Dr. Van Epi thoroughly searched scores of documents and articles for over 300 hours to prepare the citizens of the world as to the devastating results this final law will bring upon the nations, where it will forcefully be instituted and controlled. This video deals with 25 astonishing and shocking questions and answers. Here are a few. How can we tell if Islam is indeed the coming one world religion predicted in scriptures? How are Muslims pushing for Sharia law in the US and Canada? Which Christian leaders are embracing Sharia law? Which four Protestant and Catholic countries is this law presently taking control? What is the punishment for defective Muslims, Jewish and Christian infidels under Sharia law? You need answers to these questions in these critical hours of history. Get the video and discover the startling truth about the real threat of Islam and its place in these critical times.
Hello, friends. We are so delighted that you have called or written for this wonderful offer, Pope Francis, Armageddon and Christ Return. And I think you'll agree that if ever we needed to be enlightened about the future, we need it now, don't we? I trust that as you study this video, you will know even better what's coming in the future and how to prepare for it. God bless you as you view Pope Francis, Armageddon, and Christ's return. God bless you. I shall never forget what happened, and I don't think you will either, and it's my first headline that I want to share with you. Falling meteor explodes over Russia. We are going to elaborate on that in just a moment. And something else, really historic. Pope Benedict resigns in historic move. It has not been done for 600 years, and we're going to talk about that also. And world revolution to institute a new world order and a new world religion. My, Jack has so much on his heart today. We are going to get right into all of this. And as I said, I don't think I'll ever forget hearing about what happened to our planet just recently. And of course, when the meteor burst into flames over Russia. Take a look. Planet Earth dodges one extraterrestrial punch, but gets struck by another. All right, we'll talk about that. Falling meteor explodes over Russia. But take a look at that headline on the right. Phew! Asteroid slips just past Earth. Now that's a 130,000-ton asteroid that went by the Earth, the narrowest of margins. Wow, just hours after what happened in Russia. And then, of course, this is a close encounter, to say the least. Jack and I do enjoy going out for breakfast sometimes, and we have a favorite place to go for pancakes. And Spiro Giftakis is the manager of that pancake house.
Kirby's,
one of the best in our area. And when this happened, we went the next day, and he said, Dr. Van Impey, I couldn't believe what just happened in Russia and about what's just almost happened here with the asteroid. He said, is that in the Bible? I think, friends, everybody is wondering, did the Lord enlighten us about this in the Bible, Jack?
Oh, very definitely, Rexella. And the Spiro, of course, is my friend, and so I love to explain Bible things to this great Greek Orthodox man. But Rexella, what happened in Russia is minor compared to what happened there in 1908 when an asteroid hit and it destroyed millions and millions of trees and acres of land. It was really something. We haven't had anything gigantic like that since then. But this thing was kind of minor in, by way of comparison for Russia. However, let me say that when it hit, it affected 1,000 people as far as injuries were concerned and 4,000 buildings. But there was something else going on. And he mentioned this as well, this great asteroid. Get it, folks? It weighed 130,000 tons. I figured this all out. That's 26 million pounds. And had it hit, it would have been equal to 180 hydrogen bombs like the ones that fell atomically on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Oh, God help us that it didn't hit. But, you know, we talk about closeness, 17,200 miles from hitting our Earth. Guess what? Rexel and I are preaching to the whole world. But we're using the satellites in space, and they are 23,200 miles up there, and this asteroid was 6,000 miles beneath it. That's how near it was. And guess what's happening? Right now, our astronomers, our scientists are working diligently, say, because we've got to get a warning system, because there are going to be more of these things hitting. And so by 2017 or 2018, they plan to have a warning system that will give everyone a chance to realize whether they should try to escape or not. And they'll have a 1 week period to warn. Now, is it in the Bible? The Lord Jesus, Luke 21, verses 25 and 26, he said, there should be signs in the sun, the moon, the stars, and space, and it'll be so frightening that men's hearts will fail them as they look for things that are coming to pass. But it's a sign that Christ is about to return, because the very next verse, 27, says, then shall they see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with power and great glory. That's the rapture. Come up hither. And we go up in the twinkling of an eye, 1 Corinthians 15:52. 7 years later, we return with Jesus to the earth. And Rexella, Jesus went on to say, no, I got goose pimples on my duck bumps now. In verse 31 of that same chapter, when you see these things happening in space, you know that my kingdom is nigh. That prayer you've prayed for centuries. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, Matthew 6:10. That not. The generation that lives to see this shall not pass from the earth. This is the raptured generation. There in verse 32. Come quickly, Lord Jesus.
That's so exciting to know that it all points to something good.
Yeah.
Oh, well, you know, we've been discussing, friends, something very, very important. I think you recognize that, Sharia law, and the extenuating effect that it has on countries where it is observed. I'll tell you that it has a big effect wherever they observe it. Now, Jack has done extensive study. I've shown you some of the books that he has studied. But I'd like for you to take a look at this book especially, and I have referred to it, Sharia, The Threat to America, An Exercise in Competitive Analysis. I'm going to stop right here, Jack, because I would like for him, if he would, to share once again some of the research that he has done. It's not off the top of his head, friends. He's done a lot of research. That's only one book of many.
You know, we got a lot of these people and preachers saying, oh, this will never happen. Listen, I've put 300 hours just in this subject. Do you know that I now have 130,000 hours of Bible study in all of my years of ministry? I've been saying 120 for so long, well, I've added 10,000 to it in the last few years. And that would be equivalent to 13 years of 24-hour days without eating or sleeping, just constant study. And why did I do it? Because 2 Timothy 2:15 says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needs not to be ashamed. Rightly dividing the word of truth, but I did it for another reason. Because I want to be able to show you, not only through the headlines, but through God's holy word, that all these things are coming and coming very soon. Now, I have used the books of various individuals, for Dr. Merck's, for Dr. Warren Smith's, and I have used this great book Rexella just had as a picture on the stage, 20 of the leading admirals, generals, anti-Islamic fighters, those who know what's going on and are taking a stand, scores of others, 1,500 quotes from men like Walid Shobat, and just on and on and on. And I'm going to tell you, we are living in the last hours. But beyond all of that, all the books, all the 300 hours, I awaken and the Holy Spirit puts things in my mind. Is that scriptural? Listen to Jesus in John chapter 16, verses 12 and 13. I have yet many things to say unto you, Jesus said, but you cannot bear them now. Howbeit, when he, the Holy Spirit of truth, is come, he'll guide you into all truth. And I awaken in the mornings and it's in my mind as I've been sleeping. The Holy Spirit is doing some great things that I've never understood before. It's all happening in the last 2 years. And every morning I pray Ephesians 5:18, oh, Holy Spirit, fill me. Because He's enlightening my mind. He's showing me the things that are coming. He's giving me the call to be a prophetic voice to the world. I'm warning you. Get ready. Even in the light of what's happening with the Pope, it's time. And you're going to hear the subject on the one world religion and what it all means. It means Jesus is about to return. And not only when you're filled with the Holy Spirit does He give you light, but He gives you power. You shall receive power if that the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And that's what's wrong with some of you ministers. You won't even talk about Sharia law. You won't even warn your people. You think maybe Vanity doesn't know what he's talking about. And I'm sick of these fuzzy, wuzzy, namby-pamby, spineless, unable to take a chiropractic adjustment ministers. God help you to get the Holy Ghost on you and start warning the world, because our days here are limited and your people aren't being prepared.
You know, Jack, something that must take effect before Sharia law can take effect in a nation, and that is what the pastors are trying to do right now. Oh, please, don't do it. Please don't do it. Combining Christianity and Islam. Take a look, if you will, at this cover. Take a stand, ministries. The deception of chrism. Now, chrism, of course, is the combining of Christianity and the Islamic faith. This is a book by Eric Barger. Let's take a look at what he has to say. Now, deluded so-called pastors across our nation are promoting unification under the delusion that Christians and Muslims worship the same God. This is a dangerous apostasy that must be exposed and challenged. Now, that's true, friends. He's right. So many pastors across our nation are trying to combine the two religions. Do we worship the same God, Jack?
Absolutely not. Now, listen to me carefully. Here is a manuscript that has 300 names of Christian leaders in the United States of America, and it's called the Yale Covenant. And these are men who've been willing to say, we now call our God Allah. No, we don't. And two of the names on here are Schuller and Rick Warren. And thousands, thousands of you are following Rick Warren. Not only that, Jesus predicted this would come, and it's happening with Wycliffe Translators, great godly organization in the past, and Frontiers. And now they've removed in their new Bible for the Muslim nations that Christ is the Son of God 91 times, you blasphemers. We could go on and on. Warren speaks at the Muslim conventions. You'll see how ridiculous that is in a minute. And now he's got a school there, according to the Orange County Register, and he's bringing in the Muslims with his own ministers to find the similarities in this book between this and the Quran. You can't do it. My Bible says in Romans 16:17, that we're not to do anything like that. Mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine of Jesus which you receive, and avoid them. And let me tell you what's wrong with you people there translating your Bible. You're going to suffer, maybe the loss of your soul for it. Why? 1 John 2:18. He that denies the father and son relationship, and you're doing it 91 times to please Muslims because Allah didn't have a son, he is an antichrist. Enough said? We could go on and on. There's no end to it. By the way, the latest survey, and now they've taken in some of the Catholic priests along with all these Protestants, and it is now 68% of the population of America who says, we don't need Jesus. There are many ways to heaven. You say that, you're calling Jesus a liar. For Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and life. No woman can come unto the God the Father but by me. And Paul said in Acts 4:12, neither is there salvation in any other. There is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. And that name is Jesus. Praise his name. His name shall be called Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins. What's wrong with all these guys? Listen to Jesus again in Matthew 24, verses 5, 11, and 24. There shall be false Christs and false prophets. Jeremiah 14, 14. Yahweh, God sitting in heaven, says, the prophets are lying prophets in my name. I have not sent them. Listen to this. I'm talking about Jesus all the time. Matthew 7, 15. Beware of false prophets which come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. You shall know them by their fruit. God's called me to be a fruit inspector for the Lord Jesus, and I'll uplift my Savior. I don't care what you call me. I don't care what you say about me. I'm going to be true to Jesus in this book, not to another religion that takes my Jesus apart. All right, one more thing. What happens to this crowd? He said they're going to be blasphemers. Verse 15, 21 to 23. Many will say to me in that day, judgment day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, preached and witnessed and testified, and in your name cast out devils, and in your name done many wonderful works? Then will I profess unto them, I never, never knew you, you bunch of sinners, you workers of iniquity. That's the way the Lord Jesus feels. And we need an old-fashioned revival. Not these services with their rock bands and lattes and nonsense and foolishness. An old-fashioned revival that Billy Graham wants to bring. November of this year, his last message to America, his warning for an old Holy Ghost revival in this country, where it'll close the nightclubs and saloons with all these Christians even guzzling. Close the strip joints. We need that kind of meeting, not the nonsense that's going on in Christianity right now.
Jack, that is so strong. You know, something really hit me, those verses that he was quoting just now, about trying to combine the two religions. The Bible doesn't say combine them, it says avoid them. You don't combine something that is not the right thing to do.
You know why, Rick? Yes. Amos 3, verse 3, can two walk together unless they be agreed? Let me say something. I'm going to say it. I've said it many times, and I promise God I'd say it once a month. Here's what the Quran teaches. Jesus comes back, and he says, I'm not God. I'm not a deity. I lied to you. I didn't die on a cross. I rigged it. And I've become a Muslim since I left, and now I'm returning as the evangelist for Allah, and it is my job to smash every cross. And furthermore, when Mahdi, the Messiah of Islam, comes, according to Ahmadinejad, who has to kill all the Jews first, Mahdi has chosen me, the Prophet Jesus, to be the executioner and killer. We'll show you that in this program before it's over. God help us. And these men, with all of their blindness, for the blind are leading the blind, even in our Protestant churches, going to have to count to God. For Jesus said, if the blind leads the blind, they're both going to fall into the ditch.
Jack, that says so loudly and clearly that the Jesus of Islam is not the Jesus of the Bible, not the Jesus of Christianity, the Jesus that we know as our Savior, the Son of God. All right, we're going to go on here. An unexpected development. My, oh my, was it ever. Just happened as Pope Benedict XVI gave his resignation. Pope Benedict XVI, in shock resignation, the unexpected development. The first papal resignation in 600 years, and it surprised governments, Vatican, and even his closest aides. Then the Wall Street Journal, Pope resigns in historic move. And Benedict is facing up to his frailties.
He looks weak there.
Yes, he certainly does. And Pope Benedict says resignation is for the good of the church. I'm going to stop right here. And I'm going to ask Jack if he could enlighten us a little bit more about this resignation. He was the 112th Pope, and this will be 113 now coming in. Jack, can you enlighten us a little bit, please?
This Pope has said, and I've got all the articles, and this is just since he mentioned his resignation, he said, next I'm asking all the cardinals to pray much so that we do not get the next Pope who destroys the Catholic Church. Why? Because of the great prophecy by St. Malachi 800 years ago, that the 113th Pope, if you start accounting with Celestine II. Or you start with Apostle Peter, it's number 266, and he will be the defective pope. And I know there's some even priests saying, oh, we don't really accept. Yes, you do. When you hear the great Bishop Sheen, who used to be the voice for Catholicism on the airwaves, he spells it all out, and I'll do that all next week, ladies and gentlemen. But listen to me very carefully. This pope said, we need a new pope that's charismatic on television. He says, our pews are empty. It's no longer the pulpit. It's television that's reaching them. Praise the Lord.
Yes.
We're out there to every nation on the earth every single week. And then he said this about the next pope. Pray that he's not the one who destroys the church. Why is that? Because in Revelation 13:1, we have the rise of the world dictator. Verse 7 says, he has control over all kindred, tongues, people, and nation, and all the world worships him. But with him, we have a false prophet. And this is what the pope is worried about, the bad pope. And he will make an image even to the Antichrist. And he has the two horns of a lamb, but he speaks like a dragon. The two horns of a lamb associates him with Christianity, for Jesus is the Lamb of God. John 1:29, their dragon is Satan. Revelation 20, verse 2. You're going to be shocked.
I'm looking forward. Jack, and I want to say something here that's very, very important about Catholicism. Take a look at this statement, if you will, please, on the screen. Catholicism is under assault by the forces of jihadist Islam in a band of confrontation that runs across the globe, from the west coast of Senegal to the eastern islands of Indonesia. Christian communities in the Holy Land are under constant, often violent pressure. Oh, I want Jack to explain this to us very carefully, if you will, please.
This is the man who wanted to kill Pope John Paul. This pope is now under death threats by the Muslims. And you know, they went into Egypt, and the Coptics, our Catholic Christians, walked into one of their churches, killed all the priests and many of the members. They did the same thing in Iraq, killed the Chaldean priests and the people, and 2 million have died as Christians under their bloody hands. And let's see what they plan to do, Rexella.
Yes, and their plans, that's nothing new, Jack. Take a look at this, please, on the screen. As early as 1989, Europeans were shocked to see thousands of Muslims openly protest in the streets of Britain, France, Germany, Belgium, and the Netherlands, carrying signs with the provocative slogan, Islam, our religion today, your religion tomorrow. And then let's take a look at the spirit of the grand Ayatollah Khomeini. And of course, he's the one in Iran. This is the same Khomeini who said in 1981, that goes back away too, friends, I say, let Iran go up in smoke, provided Islam emerges triumphant in the rest of the world they want to take over. Now, there are a couple more statements. Jack, perhaps you'd like to read this one, please.
Supreme leader of the Islamic Revolution, Ayatollah Sayyid Ali Khamenei, announced that uprisings and movements in the Muslim countries serve as a prelude to greater developments and the rule of Islam over the whole world. And another article I have here, he says, we're going to raise our flag over every nation on earth, including the United States of America. Let's go on. This is the man who supposedly had Rick Warren speaking for him. Listen, he wasn't telling him how to get saved through Jesus. Why? Listen to this message. We see that the Mahdi will lead a world revolution that will institute a new world order based on the religion of Islam. The Mahdi will offer the religion of Islam to the Jews and Christians. If they accept it, they will be spared. Otherwise, they will be killed. How? And Prophet Jesus will be the executioner under Mahdi, and Islam will be victorious over all the religions. The one world religion. Now listen very carefully. The Bible teaches, and Ahmadinejad of Iran's been constantly talking about the New World Order. I always thought it was just the European Union. No, no, no. The Bible says in Revelation 17:10, there are seven heads and 10 horns. The 10 horns, of course, is when they divide all the world into 10 regions, like the Club of Rome's plan. And you find that in Daniel chapter 7, verses 70, 20, 24, Revelation 12:3, Revelation 13:1, and Revelation 17, verses 3, 7, 12, and 16. But get this, the seven heads, three of them are Islamic nations, and then others are the Europeans. And that's why Martin Luther and the great man Calvin of the Reform movement, both 500 years ago, taught that there would be two legs in that beast of Daniel 2, verses 31, 32, and the one leg would be Islam and the other leg Europe, the world war. And that's what Pope Benedict's been talking about. And the next pope will be the ruler under Armageddon.
You know, Jack, you and I have said time and again, and I've said it to you, friends, when you read the Bible, it's like reading our newspaper. The things the Bible said would happen are happening today. The book of Daniel said that the world would be divided into 10 different sections. It's happening today. Jack, I'm going to ask you if you'll please elaborate on that thought from the book of Daniel once again.
In Revelation 17:10, he says, there are seven heads, five are fallen, one is, and one is yet to come. Now, this is exceedingly interesting. Two of them were already passed when they saw that great image in Daniel chapter 2, verses 31 and 32. The passé ones were Egypt and Assyria. Now, we have this image that has a head of gold, and that is Babylon, that's in Iraq. And we have the chest and arms of silver, the Medes and the Persians, Daniel 5:28. And then we have the stomach and thighs of brass, Greece, Daniel 10:20, and then the two legs of iron. Now, here's what's so interesting. I never saw it until I read what, as I already said, Luther and John Calvin said, the two legs will be the two different empires, the final ones of history, the Christian and the Islamic one. And you read the names, the seven heads, you got Syria, Egypt, Babylon, Medo-Persia, all Muslim nations today. And there are four of the seven heads, and then the others are the Roman Empire, but they became very big in control. They controlled much of the world for many centuries. And then the Bible says at the end, they'll grow and multiply. There are already 27 nations. But so you see both the Islamic and the European, the two Christianity, Muslim. Everything I said today is going to happen, and soon Jesus is coming. Prepare.
Oh my, I love the first headline that I'm going to be presenting to you today. Some of them are a little down, but this one is really up, and I appreciate it so much. It has to do with a man that we all are familiar with. Dr. Billy Graham's vision for spiritual revival in America, the first headline. And then the next one, the mortal threat from Iran. Oh my. And will the next pope rule during Armageddon? Well, that is a very good question. I'm going to put Jack right on the spot with that one in just a few moments. But let's go back to that first headline, if you will, please. We're going to be honoring Dr. Billy Graham. I did not realize until I read this article, do you know how old he's going to be in November? 95. And he is praying that he will reach that wonderful ripe old age, because he would like to present something across America via television, and it is to present a revival for our time, a great spiritual awakening in America. Take a look at him. In my spirit, I know God has called us to do this, and I pray he will stir your heart to join us. Our neighbors, our nation need Jesus Christ. What a wonderful vision this man had, and certainly he's had an effect on so many millions around the world, probably one of the best known preachers, if you will, evangelists, and even in the White House that's ever been known. And you know, Jack, you started out with this man, and so did Chuck, didn't you?
Yeah. First of all, Billy Graham is going to be 95 years of age this coming November, and he wants to deliver one last message of revival via television to the entire nation, probably the entire world. Yes, Chuck and I started with him as young teenage guys. And I want to tell you something. Now, the years have passed, and Chuck is the oldest man in our ministry now. He's getting close to the age of Billy Graham, but I'm not going to give away these secrets. I'm just glad that God has preserved me so I look so much younger than Chuck. Hey, we've been buddies for 50 years, and I have to have a little fun along the way.
Right.
But seriously, the thing I love about Billy, he always preached the gospel. He's never been unfaithful to the Lord Jesus Christ like so many of our ministers are today. He said, Jesus said in John 14:60, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come unto the Father but by me. You could always count on Billy Graham preaching the gospel. And what is it? Paul said in 1 Corinthians 15:1, I declare unto you the gospel. And then tells us what it is in verses 3 and 4, that Christ died, he was buried, and he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. Paul could say in Romans 1:16, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it's the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth. To get that salvation through the gospel, which Christ did on the cross as he shed that precious blood, you've got to believe and receive him into your heart. For Romans 10:13 says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ shall be saved. And there is no other way. Acts 4:12, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. And listen to me very carefully. Some of these preachers get up and say, Galatians 3:26, for all the children of God, isn't that wonderful? Doesn't matter what religion you are. Bunk! Let me give you the whole verse. You're all the children of God by faith in Christ Jesus and his work at the cross, the death, the burial, and then his resurrection. And listen, if you don't preach that, you're never going to see the inside of heaven. Because Paul, again, through the Holy Spirit, said in Galatians 1:8-9, though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, let him be accursed. As we said before, so say we now again, if any man preach any other gospel except the death, burial, and resurrection, let him be anathema, accursed. Look it up in Webster's dictionary. It means to be damned, doomed, and burned in the fire. Enough said. Thank you, Billy.
Oh, my. What an effect he's had on millions around the world. Now, friends, with all the threats coming out of the Middle East toward the United States, Iran, and so forth, and then, of course, after North Korea had their nuclear test that brings them a lot closer to a nuclear bomb, I really believe that this cover is very appropriate on the cover of the Weekly Standard. A gathering storm. How very, very true. Threats from all over the place coming toward us. Al-Qaeda leader urges Muslims to wage holy war against who? The United States and Israel. And the mortal threat from Iran. Again, Iranian leader promotes nuclear plans. And the Iranian leader, we must prep for end of time. Of course, that comes from their supreme leader over there who says, we are developing nuclear weapons for a purpose. And Khomeini, Zionist regime, will disappear from the map. Now, the Zionist regime, of course, that's Israel. And again, Iran could reach key point for nuclear bomb by 2014. Next year, oh, it's coming so fast. Ahmadinejad, Israel's existence is an insult to all humanity. My. And again, Ahmadinejad, Muslims should mobilize to destroy Zionism. And again, Zionism is Israel. And experts say Iran's missile arsenal poses threat not only to Israel, but look at that, to the United States. Now, I really feel this from the bottom of my heart, that we need to ask Jack this according to the Bible. Do you believe that we are facing World War III and maybe even Armageddon, Jack?
Rexella, World War III is the Battle of Armageddon of Revelation 16, verse 16. I'm going to have a lot to say about Pope Benedict XVI and Armageddon later in the program. Right now, I want to say this to you. I've been preaching a message entitled, The Coming War with Russia, according to the Bible, for over 60 years, and I've not had to change anything. Now, I could get into the depth of this, but I'm going to keep it very light and simple. The Bible teaches that a nation called Russia is going to lead World War III. And that's Ezekiel chapters 38 and 39. Chapter 38, verses 1 and 2, we are hearing the terms Gog, Magog, Meshech, Tubal, and Rosh, all cities in Russia today. And Rosh is Russia in Greek, and Russia in English. And they come from the north against Israel, Ezekiel 38, 15 and 16. And that is directly north of Israel. If you draw a line from Israel to the North Pole, you go right through Moscow. All right? It's going to be a horrendous war. And it's the war of the latter years and the latter days. It's nothing that has been fought. It's going to be fought. And the Oriental armies join with Russia. Revelation 16, 12. The come out of the east, the kings of the east. And that takes in all these Oriental nations for largest armies in the history of the world. And the war is described in Revelation 9, verses 14 to 18. Loose the four angels bound in the great river Euphrates, where our troops are now stationed. Why? To slay a third part of mankind. Wow! And how? This is what they do in order to destroy that many people, 35% of the population of the world. How? Verse 18, by fire, smoke, and brimstone. This is repeated throughout the Old and New Testament. You can't miss it. The whole land shall be devoured by fire, Zephaniah 1:18. That's the entire Middle East section of the world, plus whatever's going on beyond the Middle East. Malachi 4:1, the day cometh that shall burn as an oven. Revelation 8, verse 7, a third part of the trees was burned. All green grass was burned. Armageddon. Revelation 16, 16. Now, we find that the Arab world is going to align with Russia and the Orient. And that's why you see Russia defending Syria right now. They said, don't you dare touch them. Why? Because Syria is going to be united with Russia also. Isaiah 17:1, as well as Egypt, Daniel 11, verse 40. When you study Ezekiel 38, verses 5 to 7, and Psalm 83, verses 5 to 7, it's the entire Arab world all united together for one thing. What? Psalm 83, 4, let us cast Israel off from being a nation, that their name be no more in remembrance. 18 times in Ezekiel 38 and 39, Israel is the battlefield of Armageddon. It's going to be horrible. That's why Jeremiah 30, verse 7 says, alas, for that day is great, so that none is like it. None. It's the time of Jacob. It's trouble in Jacob's Israel. 2 Kings 17:34. There shall be a time of trouble such as never was, but at that time thy people, the Jews, Israel, shall be saved. Thank God for that. But who is the main culprit behind it? A little Hitler named Ahmadinejad. And his religious clergyman, Khomeini. Oh, we're going to be dealing with this in a minute as to why.
All right, Jack, another question, although that I really have, and I know going through your mind too, who's behind all of this? Jack, you've had some wonderful experiences in the middle of the night, and you'd even wake up in the morning and say, you know, I just feel like the Lord has just really spoken to my mind and heart about certain things. And this is one instance, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Who's behind it all, Jack?
The Holy Spirit awakened me a few mornings ago, and I know these scriptures, but He puts them together in my mind as I'm sleeping, and then I wake and say, whoa! Do you know the story about Lucifer? In Ezekiel chapter 28, verses 14 to 16, God says to him, Lucifer, thou art the anointed cherub that covereth, and I have set thee so. Thou wast perfect in thy ways from the day that thou wast created till iniquity was found in thee. This anointed cherub, angel, created to serve God, sinned, and he was cast out of heaven. Why? Because of a little sin called pride. He said, I'm going to take over heaven. And that's in Isaiah 14, 12 to 14. How art thou fallen, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground which didst weaken the nations? For thou hast said in the heart, I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. I will set upon the mount of the congregation God's throne in the sides of the north. I will be like the Most High God. And the Lord cast him out of heaven. Now, that's the third heaven of 2 Corinthians 12, 2, where our God rules and reigns. There are three heavens. Satan was cast out, but do you know what? He is the god of this world system, 2 Corinthians 4, 4. He controls heavens 1 and 2. Not alone, but when he was cast out, he took 1/3 of these angels with him in Revelation 12:4, all fallen wicked angels, now called demons, demonia in the Greek. And oh, God showed me this. In Daniel chapter 10, beginning with verses 12 and onward, the prophet's in prayer, and his answer can't come through for 21 days. I'm praying and I can't get through to God. Why? And the angel Gabriel appears, and he said, Daniel, we had trouble. The wicked spirits in heavens 1 and 2 fought and kept us from coming. We're delayed. That's the power of these spirits. And then Michael appeared, and Gabriel said, now we can talk to you because we got through. Now, listen to me very careful. Do you know that there are territorial demonic spirits controlling cities and nations? What? That's right. We are told in that same 10th chapter that the one who was holding back these angels was the prince of Persia. Come on, come on. Ephesians 6:12. We wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spirit wickedness in high places. Now, let me paraphrase that so you really understand it. We don't wrestle against other human beings in wrestling matches. We wrestle against these evil spirits who are controlling the rulers of the cities and states called principalities. And this is called the Prince of Persia. And these spirits never die. These demonic spirits will always be alive, and they're still controlling the same areas as always. And Persia changed its name in 1935 to Iran. That's it. That's why Clinton came back and said, I'm so afraid, to Barbara Walters, of what is going to happen through Ahmadinejad of Iran. That's why Kissinger said, as he spoke to the European Union nations in Davos, Switzerland, they will probably have a bomb in 2013 or 2014 at the latest. And God help us, Kissinger said, they will use it. Ambassador to the United Nations for America said, they're getting ready. And the North Koreans, who are experts now at building atomic weaponry, have been moved into that area of the world to help this little Hitler build the worst thing in history, to try to destroy every Jew on earth, Psalm 83:4, and the big Satan, the United States of America. So don't ever be shocked. This one is being controlled by the evil spirit called the Prince of Persia. God, watch out. God help America and Israel against the demonic spirit that controls Iran.
Now, Jack, I'm sitting here thinking about how powerful Satan is, that he can actually manipulate nations. What can he do with us? We certainly need to be close to the Lord in these days, don't we? We do have a power, and that's from above, to overcome temptation and the things that Satan puts in our way. So, yeah. But oh, how we need to be aware.
Let's see what the outcome's going to be now.
All right, well, we're going to go on here with some very, very serious headlines. Now, I've shown you this quote before, but I have an update. Here it is. The roots of rage why the Islamic world hates, resents the United States. And we hate America. As the Arab Spring spread and democracy flourished, the United States was an ally. Now America is the enemy again. Oh my, the enemy again. You know, that boggles my mind, since we are sending them billions of dollars from America. Why they would hate us, I just can't put it together. But they do hate America, and they have some goals. Jack, there are four major goals that I would like to put on the screen right now. If you would please read those and elaborate.
Number one, Hassan al-Banna warned, Islam requires the earth, not just a portion, but the entire planet. Two, Ahmadinejad of Iran boastfully declares our Messiah Mahdi is believed to be the future Muslim world leader who will not only rule over the Islamic world, but the non-Muslim world as well. Global domination. 3, the texts and scholars of Islam teach that all Muslims must strive for global domination at all times. Not just wait idly by for the Mahdi and the Islamic Jesus to accomplish it for them. This striving for Islam's furtherance and eventual world domination is called jihad. Yes, holy jihad, holy war. 4, Abul Ala Madudi stated, Muslim nations are very special because they have a command from Allah to rule the entire world and to be over every nation in the world. Rexel, let me say something here. Perhaps the most important religious development in our time is the rise of Islamist fundamentalism. Benedict courted controversy over Islam with his 2006 speech, Faith and Reason, in Regensburg, Germany. He quoted the 14th century Byzantine emperor, Manuel II Palaiologos, saying uncomplimentary things about Islam, quotes that led to death threats against the pontiff. Now, Rexella, I don't understand this. These people can say everything rotten about our Jesus. And I said it last week that he didn't die on the cross. He's not God. He's become a Muslim. He's the evangelist for Mahdi, under him, for Allah. And lo and behold, it is his job as the prophet Jesus, Isa, in the Quran, to murder and kill every Jew and Christian who won't convert. And we can say nothing about it, but the Pope says a little thing and they're ready to put him to death. The Bible teaches, and that's not only the King James Version and other Protestant versions, but in the Douay Rheims version as well, a great Catholic Bible, that there's going to be a world dictator in Revelation 13:1 who has power over all kindreds, tongues, people, and nations. All. And that's verse 7. And it gets to the place where all the world worships him, verse 8. Why? Because there is a false prophet who promotes him into that deity. And this man is a Christian leader who's defected from the faith. How do I know? Because in verse 11, he has the two horns of a lamb identifying with Christ and Christianity. For Jesus is the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, John 1:29. But he speaks as a dragon, and that's satanic influence, satanic control. And that could even happen to Christian ministers and priests, as we'll see. And that is why Pope Benedict cried out, "Oh, you cardinals, pray that you don't vote for a pope who will destroy the Catholic Church." He knows what's coming.
Right, Jack. Well, the resignation of the Pope was quite a surprise to the Catholic Church and to everyone globally. Now, let's take a look back very, very quickly. Here he is as a young priest, Cardinal Ratzinger, and then going on. New direction for tumultuous times. The Pope, citing health, is first in centuries to resign. A final act transforms the Church. And Europe remains challenged for the Church. Europe, they're empty over there in their churches. In Pope, cardinals seek manager for media age. And Pope Benedict faces crowds in Vatican, faces confusion. Well, there were 50,000 people there saying, "We will miss you." Experts, top 5 picks for the next Pope. Here you see, Pope Benedict XVI stated long ago when I was a cardinal, "I realize that the role of the Holy Spirit in the conclave is to prevent us from electing a pope who will completely destroy the Church." Now, Bishop Sheen predicted such a day would come. Now, here he is. Remember him, Bishop Fulton Sheen. Powerful words I'd like for you to read with me. "The false prophet will have a religion without a cross, a religion without a world to come, a religion to destroy religions. There will be a counterfeit church. Christ's church will be one, the false prophet will create the other. The false church will be worldly, ecumenical, and global. It will be a loose federation of churches and religions forming some type of global association." You get that word, global? "A world parliament of churches. It will be emptied of all divine content and will be the mystical body of the Antichrist. The mystical body on earth today will have its Judas Iscariot and he will be the false prophet. Satan will recruit him from among our bishops.
That recruit him from among
powerful.
Our bishops.
Yes. Now, here's another statement, Jack. Will you read that one, please?
Catholic sources, such as St. Francis of Assisi, Bishop Sheen, and others have said that there is going to be a final pope who will defect from the faith. In 1139 in Tuam, Ireland, there was an archbishop by the name of Malachi O'Margair. Later, because he was canonized, made a saint, he was known as Saint Malachi. He had just been to Rome and said that God showed him the future. In 1138, Saint Malachi predicted the remaining succession of Catholic popes from Pope Celestine II of his day until the final pope. Get this, according to St. Malachi, there will only be two more popes to reign after John Paul II. We now have Pope Benedict XVI, so according to St. Malachi, we have one more after Benedict before Christ returns. He's coming back. If this next pope is the one, it's the return of Christ. He reigns during Armageddon. That's how near it all is, ladies and gentlemen. Let me tell you, how can this be so? First of all, I want you to know this is not my prophecy. It's the prophecy of the Roman Catholic Church. And first of all, Pope Benedict XVI said, I want you cardinals to pray so that we do not elect a pope who destroys the church. Wow. Secondly, I used to listen to Bishop Sheen. He was the greatest orator for Catholicism and television ever. And he said the final pope will defect from the Christian faith. He will be our Judas Iscariot, as you heard us read. And he will turn against Christ in the church. Okay, now listen carefully. Is that possible? You can talk all the language you want. Jesus said, this people honor me with their lips, but their hearts far from me. Titus 1:16, they profess that they know God, but in works they deny him. And one more, 1 John 2:18, Antichrist shall come. Even now are there many Antichrists. They went out from us. They weren't of us. If they had been of us, they would have continued from us. They went out and turned their back on it to prove that they weren't really of us, Catholic or Protestant. Ah, but the good news is, this is the Pope who rules when the Lord Jesus breaks through the blue and comes to earth to set up his glorious kingdom for 1,000 years. Revelation 20, verse 4, come quickly, Lord Jesus.
You know, friends, I love this time of the year. We're entering into the springtime. And when I think of spring, I think of new life. And certainly that is what we're talking about today, new life in our wonderful Savior. Now, Christianity is Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, on the cross and risen again, new life. We're going to go on with another headline here, historic choice for new pope. And also, we know his name, Pope Francis, Armageddon, and Christ's return. They're very, very closely connected, and we're going to talk at length about that one. Now, as I mentioned, we're entering into spring, and Jack and I were talking about it hasn't seemed like that in some areas of our country, but nevertheless, we are in springtime, Jack.
Oh, and you know, that's when the tree begins to release its sap, but I got another twist on that. Spring is the time when the sap begins to run and the girl begins to chase him. I remember what that was like, Greg Sella, when you were after me. Hallelujah,
okay.
Praise the Lord. But then here's another one. This couple had been going together for about 10 years and finally he said, we should think about marriage. She said, yeah, but who would have us? Oh, brother. How true. Oh, let's get into this, Rexella.
All right. Now, as I mentioned a moment ago, this is one of the most blessed times of the year. My mom always bought me a new dress for Easter, but there was so much more that she taught me, and that was about the crucifixion and resurrection. Now, Jack, there are five basic fundamentals that we need to put up front right now that we must believe as Christians in order to be followers of the Lord. Basic fundamentals.
1910, the fundamentalists created this organization. And by that name, fundamentalism, because they believed in the five fundamentals of the faith, and anyone who believed these five things, regardless of denominational tag, could be a part of it. First of all, the eternal deity of Christ, the one born in Bethlehem, was from ever, from all eternity, Micah 5:2. Yes, he's God. Christ came, who is overall God in the flesh. Romans 9:5. Great is the mystery of godliness, that God was manifest in the flesh. 1 Timothy 3:16. Secondly, he was to be born of a virgin, and he was the precious Virgin Mary. And that's Isaiah 7:14, Matthew 1:23. Behold, the virgin shall be with child, shall bring forth a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel. Amen. Which being interpreted is God with us. Thirdly, he was to die the sacrificial death by the shedding of his blood on the cross to save us. Under Christ, who loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. Amen. Fourthly, he was to rise from that grave, and he did. And there's so many wonderful texts. Christ died for our sins, he was buried, and he rose again the third day according to the scriptures. 1 Corinthians 15, verses 3 and 4. I am the Lord. And he said, I was dead, but I'm alive forevermore. Resurrection, Revelation 1:18, and we're going to deal with this in a moment. He's coming again as the King of the Kings and Lord of the Lords, Revelation 19:16, to rule and reign on this earth for 1,000 years. And this new Pope is tied in with this thing about Christ's return. Stay tuned.
Oh, yes.
I'm excited.
I know you are. I don't think I've ever seen Jack more excited about anything than what we're going to talk about in just a moment. But I just want to say, moms and dads, when you take your children to church and dress them up, teach them more. Teach them what faith in Jesus is all about. That's so very, very important. Now, some very interesting and surprising events just happened, as you well know, in the Catholic Church. Now, the first surprise, here you see it as day ends. So does Benedict's papacy. Now, everyone was very, very surprised, but it had so much, I believe, to do with his health. He could not carry on. And then going on to a second surprise, historic choice for Pope. He's the first Jesuit to be a pope and first pontiff from Americas to be chosen. Also his age. You know, everybody thought he'd be a little bit younger. That's what they were thinking. And even one maybe from Italy again. But here, this is historic. And then going on, Catholics around the world cheer church's new leader. There's so many thousands were there. And of course, they were looking for the white smoke, SOS, Catholic Church. They were looking, and finally it came. Pope, now whoa, he's really got something ahead of him to tackle church finances and the scandals. My, oh my. Go and repair my house, heard it. The Saint of Assisi now. This is very, very important to him. He's got a lot of repair work to do. And American Catholics are hopeful, but they're wary. At Masses in the United States, flock lauds choice of the new shepherd. And crowd rushes to hear Pope Francis. And of course, he chose that name. I'm going to refer to that in a moment. Pope Francis' inaugural Mass aims to ignite a light of hope. I'm going to go back to something here. And that was the name that he chose. And certainly that wasn't any surprise to him, because that was very, very important. Jack, that name, Pope Francis, can you give us a little more enlightenment on that name?
He chose Francis Assisi as his model. And this man loved animals, and I appreciate him for that, because Rick and I love these little animals. And he said this man, Francis of Assisi, was in a Catholic service all alone. And he actually heard God speaking to him, because there was turmoil within the church at his day. And the voice said, "Repair my house, which is in ruins." And he said, "That's why I'm taking the name, because of the scandal now within our church, and I'm going to repair the ruins also." We'll tell you about that in a minute.
Jack, I'm going to back up to something where the new Pope chose a very unusual name, and that is Francis, Pope Francis. And I believe it's because of that Wall Street Journal headline that I read for you. "Go and repair my house," heard the Saint Assisi. And he chose that name because he wants to repair the house of the Lord. Now, you know, every pastor, every Christian, every priest needs to be living for the Lord. This is just prior to the Lord's coming, Jack.
Oh,
we need
yes,
to be
Rexella.
Living for the Lord.
Jesus said, just before I turn, there should be false Christs and false prophets. And that's Matthew 24, verses 5, 11, and 24. And if I were this Pope, I would preach to those fallen priests the message of repentance. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Matthew 3, verse 2, and Acts 8, 32. Repent from your wickedness. Now, I want to say this. Only 1,600 have committed this sin, pedophilia with children. But you've got 160,000 priests, 158,400 have not, and these men have to bear all the shame. For you 1,600, I'm going to ask you to repent. And that means change your mind and ask God for forgiveness and tell him you're going to live for him. For he says, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, will forgive their sin, and will heal their land.
Jack, a few moments ago, you gave us the five fundamentals. The fifth one was the return of our Lord. And oh, how we look forward to the coming of the Lord. Jesus said, if I go away, I will come again. Now, when Pope Benedict was still Pope, he revived that second coming teaching, didn't he, Jack?
He really did, Rexella. I got the Catholic Catechism here, and this is so important. Now, get the reason, because there is something we're going to show you in a minute that St. Malachi said that the 113th Pope from that time onward would be the one who rules when the Lord Jesus Christ returns. And listen to this. Some of you priests need to get your catechisms out again and start preaching. The Lord Jesus Christ is coming. And remember, it was Cardinal Ratzinger who became Pope Benedict XVI who edited this new revised catechism. Number 840, for all of you Catholics, it's about the coming of the Messiah. 28:16, the kingdom of God lies ahead of us. In Christ we shall reign. 28:17, the petition is Maranatha, the cry of the Spirit and the bride, meaning, come, Lord Jesus, indeed, as soon as possible, Lord, may your kingdom come. Thank you, Cardinal Ratzinger, for that glorious message. 28:18, in the Lord's Prayer, thy kingdom come, refers primarily to the final coming of the reign of God through Christ's return. And just goes on and on. 7:69, the church longs for the coming of the kingdom when she shall be united in glory with her King, the Lord Jesus Christ. We could go on and on. Oh. Thank you, Cardinal and Pope Benedict.
Now, you know, Jack, Pope Benedict was quite a theologian. We all know that. And he certainly did revive the wonderful, wonderful reference to the coming of the Lord. Now, we go all the way back to the Lord himself. That's the one who really gave the promise of his coming again when he said, I will come again and receive you unto myself. How wonderful it is to have that promise from him. But, Jack, you want to give me some references in the Bible after the Lord talking about the coming of the Lord.
Oh, Rexella, listen. What is not said is the rapture. But I have something here from Father Gomar DePaul, Westbury, New York. And this was sent to me many years ago. And I love what this dear priest said. And he is of the Catholic traditionalist movement, which uses the Latin. And he said, we do believe in the rapture. Get this. 1 Thessalonians 4, 13-18 is still used as the epistle in the traditional Latin Requiem Mass. The word rapiamur, translated as will be taken up, and it couldn't be clearer. It means what it says, the rapture. And that's 1 Thessalonians 4, 16-18. The Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them, with the dead, in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Listen to Paul in 1 Corinthians 15, verses 51 to 54. I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, be dead, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we, the living, shall be changed. For this corruptible, the dead, must put on incorruption. This mortal must put on immortality. When this corruptible, the dead, shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal, the living, shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass that is saying, O death, where is thy sting? O grave, where is thy victory? No more death. We're going up in the twinkling of an eye when we hear the sound, come up hither, Revelation 4:1, and that's what Father DePaul was talking about when he said, come up hither. Rapiamord, raptured. Now, 7 years later, we come back with Christ. The Lord cometh with 10,000s of his saints, Jude verse 14, and this is what Pope Benedict was mentioning. Watch this, folks. This is Jesus returning. He cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see him. Chapter 1, verse 7 of the book of Revelation. Again, it's found in Matthew 24, 27. As the lightning comes out of the east and shines unto the west, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. A blast of lightning from one end of the heavens to the other. Amen. You'll know when he comes, believe me. You'll see it. And of course, the Bible mentions Revelation 19, verse 11. He comes regally, royally, majestically on that white horse. And he comes with the armies following him in heaven, the saints that were raptured returning, verse 14. And he comes as the King of the kings and Lord of the lords, verse 16, to rule and reign for 1,000 years, Revelation 20, verse 14. And then he's recommissioned, 1 Corinthians 15, 24 to 28. And his reign is forever and forever and forever on earth. And they call that day 8, and that's in the catechism also, praise God. Think of it, wonderful peace. The kingdoms of this world are become the kingdoms of our God and his Christ, and Christ shall reign forever and forever and forever. No, he's not going to be the servant of Mahdi, the Messiah of Ahmadinejad of Iran. He's going to be the King of the kings and Lord of the lords. Come quickly, Lord Jesus.
Amen. You know, Jack, I was sitting here just thinking. People can encourage us, theologians can encourage us, and books can be written, all kinds of books to encourage us. But Jack's been quoting the Bible, and that's the authority. Because men of old spake as they were moved by the Holy Spirit. Every word of the Bible was given from God. How wonderful to be able to trust in the Bible. Now, I couldn't go all the way back to Peter, the apostle, but I'm going to go all the way back to the popes of 1143, and that is Celestine II. And I want you to take a good look at all of them, if you will. We're going to go very, very quickly on here. Of course, there's some by the name of Benedict before the last one. I see some Nicholas, and you know, different kinds of popes. There's a Pope Paul, and Pope Alexander, and Pope Julius, and all the rest. Pope Leo, and Pope Francis. Whoa, that's, of course, the last one, and the present one.
113, look
yes,
at it, folks.
113. Of course, that's the present Pope right now. And something happened in 1139. Jack, would you like to read that? That's very significant.
Yeah, in that year, in Tuam, Ireland, there was an archbishop by the name of Malachi O'Magrair. Later, because he was canonized, he was known as St. Malachi. He had just been to Rome and said that God showed him the future. In 1138, St. Malachi predicted the remaining succession of Catholic popes from Pope Celestine II of his day until the final pope. You just saw them on the screen. According to St. Malachi, there will only be two more popes to reign after John Paul II. We now have Pope Benedict, and of course that's under 12. So according to St. Malachi, we have one more after Benedict before Christ returns, and he was elected this last week, Pope Francis. And friends, that is the one who will rule during Armageddon and the return of Christ, because Christ comes to put a stop to Armageddon in Revelation chapter 11, verse 18.
Oh, Don't you love that thought? He puts a stop to Armageddon. Well, now, friends, is Armageddon already beginning to kind of form itself right now before our eyes? And I'd like you to see what's happening, Obama's Mideast visit. Tricky time, low expectations. Now, he did say while he was there that he was going to be a friend to Israel. Fears of nuclear Iran frame Obama's Mideast visit. And Russia to build new heavy ICBM by 2018. Russia warns Israel and West not to attack Iran over a nuclear program. China's increasing military spending unnerves their neighbors. Tehran, Beijing to start joint ventures. Escalating threats on the Korean Peninsula. And North Korea launch stirs nuclear arms fears. And DeVos, 2013, Kissinger says Iran nuclear crisis is close. Can you believe it? And U.S. will go to war with Iran in 2013, says ex-U.S. ambassador to Israel. Oh, dear. 2013, we're living in it. Newsmax showdown, Iran's plan for a second Holocaust must be stopped. And Iran's nuclear program designed to finish off Israel, Hezbollah MP says. Not a single Jew will be left on the face of the earth. Sweeping cuts for Army and Navy. Now, here's a big one. Panetta, of course, says, hollow military if cuts occur.
Danger.
And yes, danger. Defense cuts carry dire results. Now, that, of course, came from Senator McCain. Oh, my friends, is Armageddon shaping up, Jack?
Now, if the Catholic prophecy is right, it's not my prophecy, then we are right at that hour. And Armageddon is Revelation 16, verse 16. I've been preaching on it for over 65 years to 10 million people across America and the world. And hear me, folks, that is led by Russia. Ezekiel chapters 38 and 39. Chapter 38, verses 1 and 2. Gog, Magog, Meshach, Tubal, Rosh, all cities in Russia. And Rosh is Russia in Greek and Russia in English. And united with them is an Arab group of nations. And that's Daniel 11:40, Isaiah 17:1, Ezekiel 38, verses 5 to 7, and Psalm 83, verses 5 to 7. All the Arab and Muslim nations combine, but they are defeated in chapter 39, verses 1 to 2, because they've been aligned with Russia. And the main one there is Persia, Ezekiel 38:5, and that is Iran, for they changed their name from Persia to Iran in 1935. Wow, it's here, all of it, and that's why our president is so afraid, because Kissinger and Hillary are saying it's going to come through Russia and Iran. She said, I'm afraid of Iran. Let's go on. China is with them. Revelation 16:12, they come out of the east. And the waters are dried up. And now the Anatolu dams in Turkey are able to shut off the water. Never in history has this happened. We're living at that time. And of course, not only will it be China, North Korea. Do you know they said that they're getting ready to send the missiles over from North Korea, and they're helping Iran build theirs. It's here, ladies and gentlemen. Oh, what more can I say? Christ is about to return. He's going to put a stop to it. Get ready for the coming of the Lord. First, the rapture. We're going to be gone when this happens, because that happens before the war with Russia. I'll keep you out of the hour of testing, which comes upon the whole world. Revelation 3:10. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you.
Oh, Jack, you know there's only one way that we can be prepared, and that is to put our faith and trust in what we've been thinking about this season, the Lord dying on the cross for us. How wonderful to know that when we put our trust in Him, we will be saved. I trust that you will take this song to your heart, that it will bless you, and that you will think about the cross, perhaps as you've never thought about it before. Take a look. You look beyond my fall.
Amazing grace shall always be my song of praise, for it was grace that bought my liberty. I do not know just why He came to love me so. He looked beyond.
Oh, how grateful I am, how grateful we can be that Jesus, the Son of God, died on Calvary. Oh my, will you open your heart to Him? Jack, would you give that beautiful invitation, prayer to open your heart to the Lord? Please do it. Don't neglect it. Will you pray?
My heart was so moved. Thank you, God, for my precious sweetheart, an angel from heaven. The godliest woman I've ever known. Thank you for her and what she means to me in this ministry. It wouldn't be the same program without her. Do you want to be with that Jesus who's coming soon? I mean, the signs are here. The prophecy is fulfilled. We've waited 2,000 years. It's happened. The 266th Pope from St. Peter would be the one of the 113th from Celestu. It's here. Pray it. Lord Jesus, you're about to return. I want to be ready. We don't know the day and hour, but we know it's near, even at the door. Jesus, you died for me. Thank you. Thank you for that song about the cross. The cross where I first saw the light. Do you see it? Ask him now. Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner. I failed you. But you are powerful enough to wipe away every stain of sin and then to forgive and forget it. So now I ask you, come into my heart. I receive the merits of your holy shed blood, Jesus. I receive you today as my own Savior. Come into my life and heart now. Amen.
Amen. You know, week after week, I say this from the bottom of my heart. I trust that you prayed that prayer. If ever we needed to be prepared for the coming of the Lord, we need it now. After studying this video, I think you'll agree that we need to know about the coming of the Lord and be prepared. And if you did pray that prayer, please let me know about it. There's my address. I'll be happy to send you. I say it. First steps in a new direction. Week after week, I send many, many of these out to those who accept the Lord around the world. In fact, we heard from over 180 countries last year and sent them to those people who open their hearts to the Lord. And so I just want to say, may the Lord bless you as you walk with Him every day in the future. I wish we could be there with you. Wish we could encourage you even more. But the Lord is there, and He'll walk with you. I want to leave you with this beautiful, beautiful thought. You know, after that song that I just sang for you, This is from my heart to you. Jesus took my place on the cross to give me a place in heaven. And he did it for all of us. If only our loved ones, our neighbors, would open their hearts to him. We need to be a witness for him in these days. The Lord bless you. We look forward to being in your home again next week. And until, always remember, God cares for you. So do we. So very